Hi, I'm Tamás Zahola, an iOS engineer at Shaper 3D. At Shaper 3D, we're making a professional CAD system for the iPad, which is built with UI kit and metal. We're approaching CAD from a UX-first perspective, and we've spent a great deal of effort to synthesize a coherent experience from a rich set of interactions like touch gestures, Apple Pencil interactions, and of recently mouse and keyboard input. These last two being newcomers to UI kit posed unique challenges to our developers due to their somewhat poor documentation, API quirks, and bugs. So we've decided to share a few tips and tricks we've come across while implementing their support in our app. In March 2020, Apple introduced the iPad Pro Magic Keyboard. Before this, external keyboards were basically limited to text editing, and pointing devices like mice were hidden accessibility features only. With iPadOS 13.4, the mouse and keyboard suddenly became first-class citizens for the first time on iOS. Some of you might ask, why is this a big deal, since we were told that everyone prefers touchscreens over keyboard and mouse? It's simply the most intuitive way of interacting with a computer, right? Well, yes, indeed, they are intuitive to use. That's why many of us spent the last decade rewriting software that looked like this to look more like this. And indeed, our users were happy with this most of the time. On the other hand, intuitiveness for new users is just one aspect of our tools. And my argument is that the peak performance one can achieve with their tools often has an inverse relationship to their intuitiveness in first use. Let's say that the traditional keyboard and mouse is at the center of this trade-off curve. Now, consider the steno-type machine, which is a special type of keyboard used in courtrooms for real-time transcription. Obviously, it's very high in the productivity axis, but for newcomers, it's practically unusable for typing. Or in another category, look at this Lego duck. It's for babies, so it must be super intuitive to use, right? But if you want to push the limits of what's possible with Lego, you're better off with an advanced set like this. Or consider the specialized peripherals for video editing or MIDI keyboards used by professional musicians. There's a reason why they prefer these, even though they might be intimidating for newcomers. So even though in the system, touchscreens are definitely more intuitive to use than traditional keyboards, pro users do have reason to stick with these outmoded physical peripherals because they want that boost in productivity. So the tenet of this talk is that the keyboard and the mouse keep being relevant even in 2021. Now, let's see how Apple managed to support for these peripherals into their touch-first UI kit platform. Let's start with keyboards. So what do applications use keyboards for? The obvious answer is text input, of course. But then there are these actions or shortcuts like Command N for new, Command Z for undo, Command O for opening a file, etc. We also have a bunch of modifier keys like Shift, Option, and Control, and use them to change the behavior of some actions. We also use keys for navigations, like tabbing between input fields, dismissing pop-ups, confirming them with the return key, etc. Let's talk a bit about text input, because everyone basically did this at least once via UI text field or UI text view classes. So let's do a quick recap on this, iOS development 101 style. So you create a text field, add it to view hierarchy, call become first responder and the keyboard appears, call resign first responder and the keyboard disappears. Wonderful. But actually, why does it work like this? Why does the keyboard appear when you call become first responder on a text field? Well, if you look into the UIKit header files, you will find a protocol called UIKeyInput. The documentation says that if a responder conforms to this protocol, then the on-screen keyboard will appear if it becomes the first responder. And if you follow through, you'll see that the built-in UI text field and UI text view classes indeed conform to this protocol. So that's how they display the keyboard. And actually, it's not just the built-in classes by Apple, but we can do this all ourselves too. So we create, let's say, a view and declare that it can become the first responder, set up its appearance, and then implement text insertion and deletion in this UI key protocol by manipulating an internal string state. If we did everything right, this is how it's going to look like, our own text field components. It's a rudimentary one, but indeed it's a custom text field, completely independent from UI text field or UI text view, just by simply subclassing UI view and implementing the necessary UI key protocol. Okay, so previously we talked a lot about this concept called responder, first responder, becoming the first responder. What is this responder actually is? Again, if we look into the UIKit headers, we'll find that the UI responder class, which is an abstract-based class for all the views, view controllers, and a few other components in the framework, which according to the documentation is used for event handling. Indeed, it has a bunch of methods for touch handling, key presses, and motion events. It also has a next responder property, which is another crucial aspect of UI responders, because you see, UI responders use this next responder property to point to another responder, which will handle a given UI event if they choose to not handle it themselves. Through these next responder references, we can follow through the responder chain, like a linked list, which terminates at the UI window, and then at the UI application singleton. The head of this list is the first responder, which is tracked by the window, and the application itself keeps track of the key window, if it has multiple windows. This is the window that receives key press events via its first responder. So we saw that UI responder has a bunch of methods for a variety of events. It might be surprising, but not all of these are delivered through the responder chain, namely touch events. Those are not handled by the responder chain at all. They are delivered based on heat testing the touch location against the view tree, the frames of the views in the view hierarchy. On the other hand, key presses are delivered through the responder chain, and motion events likewise. A little known fact that the target action pattern used by UI controls like UI buttons can also use a responder chain by simply passing nil as the target, in which case the action will be sent to the first responder and then throughout the responder chain if it's not handled there. There's also an API on UI application for manually sending an action to the first responder, which we'll make use of later in the talk. Okay, so we saw what is the responder chain. Let's try to figure out why it's useful. UI components form a hierarchy, right? Each view has a super view and it can have many subviews. So the views form a view tree. Now, the nice thing about the built-in responder subclasses like UI view or UI view controller is that they implement their next responder property according to this hierarchical structure. So for example, a UI view's next responder will be its super view. View controller's next responder will be the parent view controller, etc. And hierarchical input handling is useful because consider a text field like this. It wants to handle letters and punctuation key presses from the keyboard, etc. So it wants to support typing. Now, what if this text field is embedded in a dialog and the dialog has a save and close action, which we want to trigger by corresponding command S and command W shortcuts? What if we are typing into the text field and we press command S? Well, no problem, because even though the text field is the first responder, it will ignore the command S key combination. So it will bubble up to the next responder, that is the dialog. It will be able to handle the save command appropriately. And the nice thing about this structure, this hierarchical structure, is that we can iterate it as many times as we want. So it's a composable pattern. So for example, this dialog can be embedded in an even larger outer dialog, which can have its own set of keyboard shortcuts, and it can handle it if there's no earlier responder that would handle given key combination. Okay, so let's talk about how UI could let you implement these kind of shortcuts. We've seen how text input works via the UI key input protocol, but it cannot be used for keyboard shortcuts as it would cause the keyboard to always be visible on screen, and we definitely don't want that. Instead, we want to trigger our keyboard shortcuts invisibly, for which there are two ways in UIKit. One is through the UI responder presses begin change the structure methods, which we saw when discussing UI responder. Or there's another way by overriding the key commands property of UI responder with a list of key commands. So let's compare the two. The press-based API, it's a lower level API and it lets you observe each phase of a key press, like key down and key up. Key commands, on the other hand, fire only on key down and auto-repeat if a key combination is held. The press-based API lets you match key commands with arbitrary logic. You can just simply compare the incoming key code against a range, for example. On the other hand, for the command-based API, you must specify each combination individually because a single UI key command can only match a single shortcut. In the press-based API, you call the base class implementation, the UI responder implementation, to forward to the next responder if you don't want to handle a key press. With the key command-based API, it's done by UIKit, which basically continues with the next responder's command list if there were no matching command in the list of your current responder. And with key commands, there's this nice feature that you can attach metadata to key commands, like discoverability labels, that will be shown to the user if the command key is held long enough. So from this, we can conclude that it is the UI responder key commands API that is the more ergonomic choice for implementing actions and keyboard shortcuts in our application. Well, actually, it's only ergonomic if you spend some time reverse engineering its bugs. For example, there's an undocumented limitation that UIKit won't see your key commands unless you let the presses begin event bubble up to the top of the responder chain to UI application, which effectively means that the way it works is that UIKit first evaluates presses begin throughout the whole responder chain. And if anyone handles it, then key commands don't get a chance, even from the first responder. We found this by observing the stack traces leading to the key commands getter. And this confirmed that it is a UI application at the top of the responder chain that initiates the evaluation of the key command logic. So basically, presses begin has priority over key commands over the whole responder chain. There's another bug which occurs when key commands are used in conjunction with any kind of text input, like UI text fields or your own UI key input implementers. Basically, the first responder's text input is ineffective if there's anyone further up the responder chain that would handle a given key press, either by presses begin or via key commands. So even though the first responder should be the most preferred handler of input events, it is not in this case. And again, we can see from the stack trace that the private UI keyboard input instance that drives the text input system is only triggered by UI application's presses begin at the top of the responder chain. And actually, this bug has practical significance because consider a command box like this. So while typing, the first responder is a text field. However, the text field is embedded in a dialog, and that dialog wants to implement sending and canceling via key commands. So like sending the command for the return key and canceling for the escape key. Now, what happens when you try to enter a new line into the command box? Well, there will be no new line entered into the text field, but instead you will trigger the next responder's return command. which will send the comment instead. Actually, this phenomena of UI key commands hijacking input from earlier responders in the responder chain had been in UIKit since at least 2014, because I found this tweet from Peter Steinberger on Twitter complaining about this issue back in January 2014, and it is still broken to this very day. All right, but we have actually a workaround for this, and it boils down to asking the first responder if it's a text field or not. We can do this via the manual send action method we've seen earlier, which lets us manually send actions to the first responder. And then the only thing left is making sure that our key commands further up the responder chain don't include anything that would clash with the text input of the first responder, like the return key in the previous example. So if the first responder was a text field, we only return the commands that don't clash with text input. If the first responder isn't a text field, then we can return the full list of key commands that we want to support. Okay, let's talk about modifier keys. So the typical example will be the image crop tool that uses modifier keys. So by default, you draw a rectangle by its diagonal, but if you press the shift key, you force the aspect ratio to be 1:1, which is a square. And if you press the option key, then instead of drawing by the diagonal, you're drawing from the center symmetrically. So for detecting modifier keys in our app, we could be using the presses began and ended APIs. These are the low-level APIs that we discussed previously. But actually, there are more ergonomic APIs for detecting the state of the modifier keys. So for example, if you want to use modifiers to affect something that's driven by gesture recognizers, then you can use this new property called modifier flags on UI gesture recognizer that will reflect the modifier flags of the last event processed by the recognizer. Again, there's a tiny bug here that for finger and pencil touches, the recognizer won't fire their action if only the modifier flags changed between two random iterations. But in practice, this is not a concern because your fingers and the Apple Pencil is always a bit shaky, so it's constantly generating location changes either way. Thankfully, mouse and trackpad touches don't suffer from this issue. So if you hold the cursor steady and change the pressed modifier keys, the gesture recognizers do fire their action. Okay, so we saw that the modifier flags come from UI event. So if you can get hold of the UI event instance anywhere in your code, you can query its modifier flags. And actually, there's a little known UI feature that UI controls like UI button expose the UI event triggering them if you use an action method with two arguments. The first argument will be the sender, that is always the UI control itself, so in this case, the UI button. But the second argument will be the UI event that triggered the given action, in this case, the touch up inside action of the button. So if you use an action method with two arguments like this, you can query the modifier flags state from the second argument, the UI event. Then you can decide that, for example, a button was pressed while the shift key was being held and adjust the behavior accordingly. Okay, but what if you don't have a gesture recognizer and you don't use UI controls either? So, for example, you're listening for the did select row at index path callback delegate call of a UI table view, and you want to alter the behavior if the option key is being held when the selection occurs. So in AppKit on macOS, you could use NS application that share that current event, which exposes the current NS event processed by the current random iteration. But unfortunately, there's no such thing in UIKit. So you cannot do this. On the other hand, it's pretty simple to implement it ourselves because we can override the send event method on UI application, which is the entry point of all UI events to the application, and take note of the event, like by storing it in a property, and then calling the base implementation to actually do the event processing to send the UI event into the application's event loop. And then we can query this from anywhere in the application, basically, so the UI application singleton. These are actually not private APIs, so it's perfectly legal to do this. Although there's a slight disclaimer because technically there's no guarantee in UIKit that, for example, a table views selection callback will be triggered soon enough that the original event won't be overwritten by an upcoming new event. So if, let's say, the table view is triggered by the touchdown event, then there's no guarantee that the touch-up event won't overwrite the current event by the time that the selection callback occurs. On the other hand, we haven't really experienced the bugs stemming from this so far in our application, so this seems to be pretty safe the way UIKit is currently implemented. All right, navigation, keyboard navigation. Let's say we have an alert with some buttons and you want to trigger them by some sensible shortcuts, like the return key would trigger the confirm button, the escape key would trigger the cancel button, etc. In AppKit, there's a handy feature built into certain controls like NS button called key equivalent. It's a property that's even exposed in the interface builder, and when such a control is on screen and this key equivalent is pressed, then the control is automatically triggered. Basically, the action of the button will be automatically triggered via the key press. Unfortunately, in UIKit, there's no such thing as a key equivalent so far. So we have to do this ourselves. Luckily, both UI controls and like UI button and UI key commands that are used for keyboard shortcuts use the target action pattern. So we can reuse their action methods. Like this, we have an OK button, cancel button, we have their action methods. And then we can pass the same action methods to the key commands for the corresponding keyboard shortcuts. Of course, key commands are always delivered through responder chain, so we have to make sure that our view controller becomes actually part of the responder chain. So we either have to make sure that it becomes first responder upon appearing from view did appear, or make it part of a responder chain by making an embedded view like text field or something the first responder. Another kind of navigation is tabbing. So sometimes you want precise control over tabbing order among input fields, like we do in Shaper 3D with this 3D transform control, with the three rotation axes and the three translation axes. We want to tab across them in a specific order that makes sense for our editor. Again, this is something that AppKit is better than UIKit, because in AppKit, NSView provides the next key view and previous key view properties that can be overridden to have precise control over the tabbing order. And there's no such thing in UIKit. Well, actually, there is such a thing, although it's a private API. So if you look under the hood, you'll find in UI responder that there's the underscore previous key responder and the underscore next key responder properties or method that can be overridden at your own risk, of course. But those can be used to control who the next and previous responders will be when the tab key is pressed. But if you don't want to use private APIs, you're sort of stuck with the built-in behavior, which is top left to bottom right based on the screen position of the input fields. This can be also checked. This was also determined by a bit of a reverse engineering. You can see at the bottom that the method that decides who is going to be the next responder is called top left to bottom right view compare. And of course, you can also use UI key commands with the tab key if you want to use it manually, if you want to do tabbing manually. But it's a bit of a menial task to do, and it seeps into all of your view controllers if you really want to do it thoroughly. So it's not really something that I can recommend. All right, let's talk a bit about mouse. So prior to iOS 13.4, we had touch types for finger touches, and then the Apple Pencil came out, and pencil touches were introduced. Now iOS 13.4 introduced a new touch type that's called indirect pointer touches, and those represent trackpad clicks and mouse clicks. So mice usually have at least two buttons. Those are represented by this UI event button mask enum that has two cases, one for the left button, one for the right button. Those are called primary and secondary, because that's a semantic naming scheme that Apple uses. But an interesting undocumented feature of this is that the bitwise OR of the primary and secondary enum cases can be used actually to recognize middle button clicks on mice that have a third button. And then, of course, there are a bunch of mouse and trackpad related features added to certain gesture recognizers. Like UI tab gesture recognizer got a new property called button mask required that can be used to limit a given tab gesture recognizer to only recognize trackpad and mouse clicks. Mouse wheel movements can be recognized by UI pen gesture recognizers by setting its maximum number of touches to zero, kind of a weird choice. And then there was a new gesture recognizer called UI hover gesture recognizer introduced for recognizing the cursor's hovering over a given view without any mouse button being held. But like I said, mouse support was sort of grafted onto an existing touch-based API. So UIKit was designed to be touch first, and then at version 13.4, mouse support was introduced. So it shows in some places that there's a discrepancy between the original design of the framework and the mouse support. So for example, before these additions, you could basically re-implement all the built-in gesture recognizers by subclassing UI gesture recognizer and overriding these touch handling methods with your own logic. Well, this is no longer possible for mouse and trackpad gestures, because the UI gesture recognizer base class got no new methods for hover and scroll wheel events. You must use the built-in gesture recognizers for these, period. You just can't do it with your own logic. And actually, don't be surprised if you encounter a weird behavior with these kind of gestures. So for example, the should receive touch delegate method won't be called for hover or scroll wheel recognizers, because they don't have touch events at all. They don't have UI touches at all. They work at the UI event level through private APIs, and you just can't use should receive touch, for example, to control their behavior. Also, before iOS 13.4, you could basically ignore all the gesture recognizer APIs and use UI responder directly by overriding the touch handling methods in a custom view class. For example, if you were writing a game or full screen application with a completely custom OpenGL rendered UI, you could do it with a simple full screen view and overriding these touch handling methods from UI responder. Well, this is, again, no longer possible for mouse and trackpad gestures, because UI responder got no new methods for handling hover or scroll wheel events. So we must use the built-in recognizers from them. There's simply no other way to do it, at least as of iOS 14.5. Okay, let's talk a bit about this neat feature that is the magnetic cursor as you can see on the right, it's about the cursor being attracted to nearby UI elements, which is to facilitate easier aiming on a smaller trackpad of the iPad Pro. It can be configured by UI pointer interaction. And the basics of this were shown in ADDC, so we won't really cover these. It's not too interesting. And even UI button has a built-in version of this interaction by default that can be enabled by flipping a Boolean property. But for your own views, you need to instantiate a UI pointer interaction yourself and become a delegate and implement this pointer interaction region for request method, which has three arguments. One is the interaction itself, one is the region request, which contains the location of the cursor, one is this default region, which is basically the bounds of your view, and then you're supposed to return a region or nil. And most of the time you would wonder, why is this API looking like this? I just want to return the default region always, so why do I have to do it at all? Well, actually, the point of this is to support some advanced use cases of cursor magnetism. So for example, consider an app that has a screen's worth of content that's not drawn by UI use, but by OpenGL, Metal, Core Graphics, etc. So let's say you have a 3D editor, a game, a drawing up, whatever. So on the right, in this example app, these red squares are drawn with Core Graphics in a single full screen view. But let's say that we would still want to make parts of this content interactive with cursor magnetism, because that would make our game or our editing application more intuitive to use. So how do we do it? Well, one idea could be that we could position a transparent view over each of these squares and add the UI pointer action to each of these transparent views, while making sure, of course, to reposition them if the underlying content changes, if new squares appear, then we need to instantiate new views and stuff like that. And that's a ton of work. That's creating a quadratic, an n by m number of views, a ton of layouting each time the content changes, a ton of bookkeeping of keeping them in sync. So it's not really a good way of doing it. And actually, this weird delegate call actually lets us implement in a much more elegant way. So basically what we do is implement pointer interaction region for request in a way that our squares, so this underlying non-UI kit content, is not represented by UI views, but instead only through our calculations. So in this case, this grid is drawn with three parameters, an offset, a size, and a spacing value. And basically, we use a simple division to decide which square the pointer location is closest to, and then return that from this region for request delegate call. And what this does is basically, instead of instantiating a quadratic number of views, we have a single view, a single UI pointer interaction, yet we support an arbitrary number of interactive elements within a single large view. So the difference is basically between this one, you can see that there's a ton of useless empty views in this view hierarchy, and this, where you can see that you only have a single view. And you can see that it works wonderfully, so the user cannot really tell that there are no views actually there. The magnetic cursor works as expected. All right, that was quite the ride, I guess. I hope at least the iOS engineers could mostly follow along. Thank you for your attention, and let's do a Q&A session.